welcome to Legally Speaking with me, Tarun Nangia. The finance ministers of the G7 nations, namely, what is the G7? The United States, the United Kingdom, Canada, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, and the European Union. They have announced an agreement on June 5, which states that they would like to reduce the corporate tax rate to 15%. How will this measure help the industries around the world? Will it make them more competitive? What is the fallout of this? And what is the impact on India? You see, our country, under the leadership of Prime Minister Narendra Modi, announced a decision to lower the corporate tax rate to 25%. They have been progressive in encouraging the industry. But what is the way forward? We will discuss today. We have an eminent panel. I have with me Rakesh Nangia. He heads Nangia Anderson & Company. Welcome, Mr. Nangia, on the show. I have with me Mr. Alok Sriram. He is Managing Director of DCM Sriram. Welcome so much, and happy to see you again on my show. I also welcome Mr. Gagan Kumar. He is a lawyer, heads a firm called Krishnomics Legal. Thank you, Mr. Kumar, for joining us today. We will start from the outset that the announcement was made, and there was a response from global business leaders who have responded very positively to this. Mr. Nangia, could you share in your opening comment how it all started? Was there a demand earlier, and how is this progressing?
Tarun, just to give you a background, this 15% tax rate, which is announced by G7, is basically not the tax rate of the global companies to go down. Like India has a tax rate of manufacturing of 15%. This 15% was basically a global minimum tax rate, which the G7 country, along with the OECD, wants to formalize that the corporates who are not being paying taxes, the big electronic company, electronic giants, basically, and there was a model which was a BEPS model, base erosion profit shifting model, basically. So these companies must pay certain taxes. What was happening, these countries, you see them, that they were trillion net worth company, they were billions, hundreds of billions of turnover company. They were based as a jurisdiction which was a low tax jurisdiction, or there was nil taxes or practically low taxes. And when they were doing business in other countries, suppose like in India, they were not paying taxes neither in India, neither in the home country, because those were the low tax jurisdiction. So what happens, there's a base erosion. India was losing the taxes, those countries had a lower tax rate, and hence what happened, the companies were becoming so-called richer and richer and not paying the taxes, which every government wants that the fair share of taxes must be paid in the country where the economic activities are carried on. So this rate of 15% is a rate nothing to do with the tax rate. This is a rate where the G7 country decided, yes, this minimum tax rate must be paid by these countries who have not been paying taxes at all or paying a lower tax rate. So there's a minimum global tax rate.
So for my viewers, I want to make it simple. You mean to say any business entity deriving business out of this country, which is India, if we take India as example, even if it is registered outside, should pay some minimum tax in India. Is that what you're saying?
So basically what happens is when you're taking a certain treaty exemptions, India is a country which is basically we call them a source country, a country where the business is carried on. So what happens is, and there are countries where you belong to, which is a resident company where you're coming from, where you're registered basically. So when you structure your business in such a way, you end up paying no taxes. So one of the criteria was that you need to pay certain taxes because of global planning structures and other things. You are not paying taxes at all.
So that's how very interesting. Mr. Gagan Kumar has been handling a lot of such tax disputes. I think he will be able to give clarity on any disputes that are existing in this domain currently. Do you think, Mr. Gagan Kumar, A, what this entails? And secondly, are there even existing tax disputes where India is contesting that companies operating in this country have not been paying India taxes?
Thanks, Tarun. You see, as we say that nature has five elements, and one of them is referred as Akash. The nearest English translation is ether. Now, if you look at the digital economy, all the companies are cloud-based, and that is where the territories are being drawn. So as Mr. Nangia also mentioned, that in a brick-mortar economy model, it was easier to trace the source of income. which becomes quite challenging in case of a digital economy. And that is where the issue arose that how to tax these companies who are making billions of dollars of income and profits, but are located in low tax jurisdiction, maybe in Ireland or a Cayman Island, and are not paying any taxes either in their home country or precisely the market economies, which are being referred as the emerging economies by the G7 statement. So companies like Facebook or Twitter, they are making billions of money by way of advertisement revenue or other activities, but they are not paying significant amount of taxes in India, or for that matter, any other source country. If you look at it, as they say that death, childbirth, and tax, there is never a convenient time. So in 2016, we imposed a tax called equalization levy. The idea was to gather tax on those revenues where the decision has not been reached by the international community that which country will have a right to tax. And that is what initiated the concept of what is known as GAFA tax, which stands an acronym for Google, Apple, Facebook, and Amazon. So currently, yes, there is a contention, not a dispute as such, that which country will have a right to tax. By way of numbers, equalization levy during the past financial year did result in a tax collection of about 1,500 crore for India. And that is where the situation stands as of now. And now the discussions are going forward as to how to bring consensus.
Equalization
about
levy
decision.
In India, 1,500 crores. I'll take this to Mr. Sriram now. Mr. Sriram, as you all know, has been earlier heading the PhD Chambers of Commerce, where he represented a lot of manufacturers and business people. He also primarily runs a brick and mortar business, but he would also be knowing that many companies in America and the UK have been paying close to nil taxes because they are, as my panelists said, being based in jurisdictions which are in tax havens, as they say. What does a businessman like him, who's primarily in the brick and mortar industry and has represented a large part of that industry, feel when these kind of measures are being taken? Because someone like him or his ilk has are bound to be cheated, that a lot of companies just get away without paying taxes.
Okay, thank you, Tarun. I just like to start by saying that I am very happy that in the G7 meeting, two topics were taken up very strongly. One was the vaccination development globally through some sort of consensus, which is taken up by Boris Johnson. And I think this is really the need of the hour. The second is the focus back on environment. I think Mahatma Gandhi put it very rightly that the world has enough for man's needs, but not enough for man's greed. And I think bringing a focus on environment is something we all who are senior businessmen and senior bureaucrats, senior politicians need to look at, that we bring the environment back in control and hand it to the next generations. So that's just a sort of opening remark. As far as the taxation is concerned, I think Rakeshji put it very correctly. This is not that they're demanding that all countries should bring tax down to 15%. It is that a minimum of 15% should be charged all around the globe. And I think this is something which is very positive, because we've known of very clear cases where countries have benefited by having zero tax and having economy develop. But suddenly, when the tax is withdrawn or a new tax is imposed, these large corporations just move out of those countries overnight, leaving a huge vacuum and hitting those countries very hard. And I think this is something which is not a good thing. I think people doing business must pay some taxes. As Chanakya used to say, 16% of income should be given to the government for tax purposes, for development, redistribution, whatever they need to do. And I think this is something which is a positive development in my mind. Brick and mortar industries obviously cannot shift around like this because of their very nature. Today in the IT-enabled and IT world, it is possible, but I think it should be plugged. And I think India has been very, very advanced if you look at it, we have this thing called minimum alternate tax, the MAT. So even in India for many years, many companies were able to take benefits of various concessions and subsidies which the government gave and were paying very minimum tax irrespective of the size of the company and their turnover. So the government introduced an MAT, which is, I think, about 17% on book profits, which is, I think, a good thing. They allow it set off. So it's very simply a situation where you keep making profits and you can set off those MATs in the future. So I think India, in a sense, is already looking at that. We have already brought down the tax rate from 33% to 25% and an MAT of 17%. So I would say that we as an industry body feel that this is a positive situation.
Positive situation. I'll take this question to Mr. Nangia. Where do you see India's position in all of this? Where are we headed?
What happens is India global, because once we talk about the G7 or we talk about India position, one interesting and good thing which happened last year and a half back, when we became as a global tax competitive jurisdiction. If you see 15% of the new manufacturing company, the tax rate which is announced by the government basically, which is completely effective now, has among the lowest sort of in the world. I'm not comparing myself to Singapore or Mauritius or these companies, but as a reasonably good sized company, 3 trillion company, a 15% is a very fair taxes. It encourages the investment. It brings the foreign the investment in India. At the same time, leaves money for you to invest back in the business and pay a fair amount of taxes to the government. You know, if you see the way the slight downwards fall in the tax rate from first 5 days of 97% down to 15%, I think it's extremely very positive, encouraging, and a very, very fair, because the business must contribute a reasonable amount of taxes to the government exchequer. India is a developing country. They rely on this source of revenue of taxes. It's a prime source of money. We're still collecting 10 lakhs crore of taxation even during this year. It's likely to cost 10 lakhs crore in this year. It's not a small amount of money, basically. So 15%, fair, globally competitive, if you see all over the world. It's very competitive, very encouraging to the businesses, to the new businesses, even for the migration of the business, including the supply chain migrating to India, basically. It's a very, very fair amount of
Fair amount. I'll take this to Mr. Gagan Kumar. Mr. Gagan Kumar, what are the challenges do you foresee? As a lawyer, do you foresee any challenges with this system happening in India especially?
See, I will be a little circumspect because you see, the way this and the timing of this G7 declaration, equalization levy was imposed by India and many other countries. And as a result, retaliatory measures were being considered by US, which have been put on hold as of now. Now, this statement has come that there would be a global minimum tax rate of 15%. Look at the intent. I will be a little circumspect and skeptical also. To me, this looks like a ploy to propitiate the emerging economies and to refrain them from levying tax on digital economy. Why I say so? Look at the recent initiatives which government has taken, and every government is taking it, regardless of the economy. US is talking about make America great again. We are talking about Atmanirbhar Bharat. As a result, areas like Gift City are being propagated where a negligible tax rate is being proposed. The tax on manufacturing sector has been reduced to 15%. Now, think of a situation, because that 15% proposed by G7 is tentative as of now. To me, it looks like a proposal which would kill that arbitrage and may not be suiting the companies who would be willing to move their businesses in countries like India or any other emerging economy. And that would take away the tax arbitrage. So I would be little circumspect again if I were to negotiate with the companies or the countries in G7 or G20. I would be little circumspect with this proposal.
Go to Mr. Sriram on this. Mr. Sriram, do you foresee any challenges yourself with such proposals?
Look, I cannot answer that. I think Gaganji and Rakeshji are better equipped to answer this because they are dealing with this all the time. However, I would just like to say that if we are able to get a rate of 15% all around the world, it will make us much more competitive, because I think developing countries are not really giving a full tax exemption. It is small tax havens and city states really which are doing this. And we know that there are nameplate companies all over there which are taking benefits of these things. And I think that will be hit to a large extent, and companies will find it not cost effective to go there. They would rather create the necessary infrastructure in developing countries and actually do the full business and pay the tax as it stands. So I hope that this will actually help developing countries.
Okay. Okay. Point taken. Mr. Nangia, do you see any challenges on this proposal?
Yeah, I tell you one thing, very interesting part, which I want to tell, which is still a gap. What is this proposal basically? The global companies, the giant, who were not paying the taxes anywhere globally, G7 came to a conclusion, a consensus, that the 20% of the global profit of these companies should be taxed where they do the business. If Amazon is doing a business, that 20% of the profit in some way should be allocated to India, to the market economy, where the users are based, where they sell the goods. So if Amazon is based in US, they may not necessarily pay taxes in India. Just for example purpose, they may not pay taxes in India. So what the G7 decided? G7 decided that 20% of the profits should be allocated to markets where you do the business. And second, what they said, if you're based out of Ireland, if you're based out of different countries, you must pay 15% of minimum tax rate in those countries also. It should not happen you pay 5% in Ireland or 7% in Ireland or 8% in Singapore. So G7 had two things important part, allocation and second, minimum taxes to be done that. Why should be done? Why not these companies should pay taxes? This is a global debate. This is a debate all over Europe, all over in European Union, every part of the world where the business are being done. These companies are not paying taxes, not because of any reason. They're taking advantage of the treaties, which provides them a low tax jurisdiction. So they're doing it legally. But those countries must either change the law and become as parapassive to the world they want to do that, or these companies must pay taxes. You cannot go scot-free. That's the basic objective of G7 were there. Yes. When you make a proposal like this thing, G7 is seven countries. Let me tell you, interesting. They control 80% of the economies of the world, GDP of the world, these G7 countries, right? And then you have other countries, which are 139 countries, pitching for the same thing. Imagine the challenge to tax these few companies, giants, few giants, actually. The G7 has failed for the last 10 years. The OECD has failed. Even today, I can tell you one thing, even you start implementing today, it will take you years, years and years why the global consensus can be reached and it can be operationalized. Otherwise, it will never go into operation. And I tell you what will happen. By the time the business global will become more digital, more electronic, you will not be able to trace it. The world will become digital. Tomorrow, the business is digital. Today, the world is becoming digital. You will not know the flow of the business taking place. Even today, can you make the flow of the business? No, it has changed completely. You need to tax them. And the worst thing I must tell you, thing, they are moving faster than the tax laws are moving. If you think something, they're three steps ahead of you. Can you track them? You know, digital economy is a decade back. And you know, this change was brought after 100 years of changing the law. After 100 years, the tax system is going for complete ramp. And I'm telling you today, it is still not going to catch it up. They will still lag behind because the business will move faster, the mind will move faster, the intricate business model will move faster, basically. The business size will become bigger.
You have made a very two interesting points. One, you mentioned 139 countries will be more than willing to provide lesser taxes so that these companies are based and they will not cooperate with the G7. I'll go to Mr. Gagan Kumar at this point. If that is the case, of like Mr. Nangia is saying, hey, what's the scene for countries like India? Because India is not a tax haven, but India is also constantly grappling with the challenges to tax companies who are either based in Singapore, Mauritius or other places and doing business in India. It is also with the cards business. There are so many other businesses where India has this problem. What kind of situation will countries like India be in? And with these 139 countries, most of whom actually derive income by allowing these companies to be registered there, do you think this will lead to nothing like Mr. Nangiya thinks?
See, you'll have to understand, as Mr. Nangiya pointed out, this is a two-fold approach which has been proposed. One is that 20% of the profit over and above the 10% profit ought to be distributed what is called as market countries. And I am a little offended by that term market countries, because I find it nothing but a euphemerical way of calling us colonies. So that's one. Second is the 15% tax rate would be the minimum tax rate in the home country. So suppose Google is paying 3% tax in Ireland and making profits there. Some profit will be distributed to India, and the balance, the difference, will be taxed in US. And that would, the mathematical, the back of the envelope calculation is about $50 to $80 billion of taxes will be collected by these G7 countries. So we should not get very excited that it is going to be very beneficial for emerging economies. In my view, it is not. And I'll tell you another thing. In my view, it is going to raise further issues. See, the point is, currently we have something called transfer pricing regulation, whereby we test each international transaction on arm's length price. Now, on top of that, this 20% grant will be given. So something to nibble away. We should not get too much excited, because you see, this will lead to too much of tax litigation in India, and administratively it will not be cost effective. So unless the broad contours are decided at this time, I would, as I said earlier, I'll be a little circumspect.
Okay, point well taken. I'm going to Mr. Sriram. Mr. Sriram, you represent industry bodies where you, in a sense, jog your mind along with so many other business owners in India. Be it the Tatas, the Birlas, or other erstwhile, they all have offices, head offices in Bombay or Delhi or other places. They have been paying taxes here. So this new culture where a new set of companies come, make a lot of money in India and try not to pay tax. Do you think industry bodies like you are worried? Is this even brought up in discussions, or, you know, it's not that much of a concern for you because you're okay with it?
I think it is something that we have to understand, that companies are economic animals and they will always go towards a place where they can retain the maximum amount of their cash flows and earnings. So there will always be a situation like that. But I don't think Indian companies are of that global size and scale by and large. There will be a few. But by and large, we are not of that size and scale where we are able to set up institutions just for tax saving in many of these countries. There will be some odd people, there'll be some odd models. I'm sure there are. But fundamentally, I don't think Indian taxpayers, Indian corporate entities are really taking advantage of these tax havens and loopholes. So I think it should be beneficial for India. But as both my panelists said, this is not a simple thing. The announcement has been made, but it's going to take a long time to sort out the actual legalities. And these are legalities which have to be sought out country by country. It's not that someone in G7 will issue a diktat and it goes through. Each country will have to then make out the laws and the procedures which are in line with such a basic intent or this. I can't even call a decision. It will be an intent.
Thank you so much, Mr. Sriram, for sharing that opinion. Thank you, Mr. Sriram, Mr. Nangiya, Mr. Gagan Kumar, for participating in the show. I would ideally want to do in another quarter or 3 months, revisit this issue, see how it plays out, because it is an agreement. How will it be implemented? We only will come to know. 3 months is too short a time for such things. So we'll have to see as it goes. But thank you so much for participating in this engaging discussion. Viewers also would have enjoyed it. Thank you, viewers, for watching this. Thank you.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.